Thanks, Jeff, and welcome to our panelists today. Great to see all your familiar faces. We have Eric Griego, former Democratic State Senator, now UNM Poli Sci Professor, Dan Boyd, Bureau Chief at the Albuquerque Journal, and Merritt Allen. Great to have you back too from Vox Optima Public Relations. Thank you all.
Thanks.
Now, Senator Martin Heinrich and all three Democratic congressional candidates walked away this past Tuesday with wins on election night. Let's start in what we know would be the closest of those contests. That's CD2. Democrat Gabe Vasquez won over former GOP Rep Yvette Harrell. Eric, let's start with you. How did he do that?
You know, he kind of defied a lot of the results in the rest of the state, to be perfectly honest. I mean, you know, that district changed. Last time around, he just kind of squeaked it out, 1,300 votes or something. And this time it was more like 10,000, which was, you know, significantly better. I think even though the polling was showing that he was going to do well, I think he did better than certainly folks thought he was going to do despite the polling. I think I was looking at the numbers and, you know, more than half the district is in Bernalillo County and Doniana County. So he did really well there. I mean, he actually, Harrell actually won more, nine of the 15 counties. And, but he won pretty overwhelmingly in the two big, most sort of urban and, you know, arguably the most sort of Democratic progressive counties. And that was enough to put him over the top. I mean, I think the difference was, you know, given this change in the district, I think, you know, Yvette Harrell was much more sort of a good fit when it was a little bit more sort of a Republican leaning district. And I think the district's changed significantly. There's a lot of rural counties where, you know, a lot more conservative and Republican voters. But I think given the fact that these two big counties with a lot of Democratic and progressive leaning voters really are, you know, make up most of the district now. And that's where you know, Vasquez spent a lot of his time. And you know, I live in the district here at the edge of Albuquerque, and he spent a lot of time here and had a lot of support. So I think that was a big part of it. The change in the district, just the fact that Harrell, I think, is not the fit that she used to be. And then, you know, these two big counties really coming in strong for him.
Okay. Merritt, do you see it the same way? The district playing the largest role here? I know Harrell sued over that last election and lost. But was this a failure in her campaign messaging or just a situation of
or was it gerrymandering? Why, yes, it was gerrymandering. I mean, putting Roswell and Albuquerque, it was putting Roswell into three districts is nuts. And then Speaker of the House Brian Eagle was pretty open about what he intended to do with redistricting in 2021. And lo and behold, he did it. I took a pretty active role in efforts to enact an independent redistricting. So this is a cause that's near and dear to my heart. I served on the independent redistricting committee. We put forward our recommendations for an independent redistricting commission. Newly reelected Representative Rebecca Dow really took that forward in the 11th hour. Legislation was passed to establish a commission. A lot of the teeth were taken out so that, of course, the legislature would take the recommendations of the commission and then do whatever they wanted. And that is precisely what happened. What I think is really interesting and a good example is Congressman Vasquez also has taken some pains to try and play to his district. And I shouldn't say that. He's actually, I think, trying to represent his constituents. One example would be where you see some really progressive legislation being taken up by other members of the delegation. He didn't even vote when there was a resolution honoring Billie Jean King. He felt that was not going to play well with his constituents. So I think Vasquez is listening to his constituents. And in this day and age, you'd say, oh, he's just doing that to be reelected. Maybe he's trying to be sensitive and respect what he thinks is important to his constituents. So he is playing a little more conservative. He does take a less progressive stance than perhaps other members of the delegation. And I think that is a smart play for Vasquez. You know, Yvette Harrell is a family friend. She got her start as the legislative aide for my mother, the late Representative Diane Hamilton. So I've certainly known former Congresswoman Harrell for some years, and she is a very tough campaigner. She is a very hard worker. As soon as, you know, even though there were lawsuits over the gerrymandering, the instant that district was redrawn, she was in the South Valley. She was working it. So I think she did the best she could with the district she was given. I just think it's a really terribly envisioned district. It's, you know, there, when you think about, you know, the requirements of compactness, of all the things that you want to see in redistricting, CD2 meets none of those requirements. Yeah. Cities of interest, it's just not there. So it'll be interesting to see what happens in 2030, I think.
Okay. Now, Dan, Senator Heinrich, he beat his Republican challenger, Nella Domenici, by 10 points. In a story of yours this week for the Journal, you quoted Domenici telling her supporters that they shouldn't see this as a loss, but the beginning of a movement. Did you see anything in that race to indicate that she's right? And what else were your takeaways from that one?
Well, I thought it was interesting. You know, she ended up losing to Martin Heinrich by about 10 points, you know, which was a wider margin for sure than the presidential race. So there were some voters out there who voted for Donald Trump and for Martin Heinrich. And I haven't talked to them yet, but I'd be interested to hear that perspective. For me, it was interesting to see how at first she kind of tried to keep Trump at an arm's length a little bit and declined to say whether she would support him. And then kind of in the final weeks of the campaign, kind of fully, fully bought into that, spoke at the Trump rally and said she would vote for him. But I wondered if that initial reluctance maybe, you know, cooled the support of some Trump voters who might have voted for her. Actually, you know, the race this year was actually a bigger margin than 4 years ago with Mark Ronchetti and Ben Ray Lujan. So I think Republicans can take a lot of positives from this year's result, but I think in the Senate race, you know, clearly that there's more work to do, and Republicans still haven't been able to win statewide and, you know, in the last several statewide cycles.
Wow. Now, after his win, Heinrich told KRQE's Gabrielle Burkhart that his top priority heading to Washington was a spending bill, specifically one that secures funding for our national labs. Now, just a few weeks ago, he sat for a 22-minute interview on our air with Gwyneth Doland. They talked about things like crime, fentanyl, abortion, housing, and we didn't get the impression that lab funding was his top priority or his day one focus, for that matter. Eric, does the fact that we now have a Republican Senate, executive, and possibly House change the priorities of the people that our state elected to represent us?
I don't think it changes the priorities. It's certainly going to change. It's going to make their job much tougher. I mean, it's rare that you have sort of, you know, the House, Senate, and the White House in the same hands. And when it does happen, you know, that's when, to the extent that our system allows major policy change, that's when you see it. And, you know, certainly when you have a president-elect who's as motivated to change, to make major changes as this, as former President Trump said he wants to, I think it's going to be tough. So I think even though the margin is going to be pretty close, we don't know where the House is going to be. It's going to be really tough, and it's going to be a lot of defense for Senator Heinrich and Senator Lujan. I don't expect the Trump administration to come after the labs. It's been one of the areas where there's been pretty bipartisan support. However, I think there were earlier in his career, Senator Heinrich was definitely pushing for much more diverse mission for the labs, and especially Sandia, you know, much more on the sort of renewal side. I think that might be the one area where potentially, given what President Trump has said about his views on renewable energy and the green economy and so on, that some of the funding there may shift more into the sort of the nuclear sort of the nuclear side, the nuclear sort of stockpile stewardship and all the other missions that they have there. But I think, you know, it's going to be tough for Heinrich and Lujan and for the whole delegation, because now it's looking like they're going to be in the minority in both houses, and they don't have a president that's really sees the world the way they see it. So I think it's going to be a lot of time on defense and trying to just sort of keep really bad things in their view from happening politically. And It's not the first time they've been in this situation in terms of having to work with this president and being in the minority, but this is the alignment that I don't think most of us saw coming, which is, you know, a pretty strong result for President-elect Trump, you know, picking up more seats than I think some of us expected in both the House and the Senate. You know, times are going to be tough for the Democrats in the Senate and in the House.
Okay. Now, I know there was some concern for Democrats here in New Mexico watching totals come in Tuesday night after delays in Bernalillo County that made things look like Republican Steve Jones had a real shot at taking down Monty Stansbury. That ended up not being the case with the final results once those came in. Merritt, what did you see in the other two congressional races that both ended up as 12-point wins for Democrats?
Well, I was covering election night on KKOB with TJ Trout. And so, yeah, we did note that. I was really struck as a resident of CD1 by Steve Jones' race. And of course, that was interesting because we had somebody from Ruidoso running in CD1. But he was a very, I thought, Bernalillo County friendly Republican, very moderate. I thought he ran a very smart race. I was struck by the cordiality of his concession speech. I think he was a very good candidate. I also the CD3 race, that was tough because I'm such a fan of Sharon Klotz Shillage. She was such a great legislator. She has so much good to say. And if you looked at her campaign war chest, I don't think she got over $100,000, compared with the Democratic incumbent. So, you know, 10% perhaps. And the fact that she got 44% of the vote with so little funding, all through hard work and bringing real issues to the table, I thought she had a tremendous finish. And those two races were just not really well supported, I feel, by RPNM. It all went to CD2. That was the only thing that mattered. So I thought that was a real shame that the support wasn't spread around statewide. And I think that's a problem. I think that's one reason why you see the entire congressional delegation, all the statewide races, going to Democrats in a state where just over 2/5 of voters are registered in the Democratic Party. That does not, to me, look like one person, one vote. And I think it really is up to Republicans to look at that and really focus, truly focus their priorities statewide in the future.
Now, Dan, I want to end with you here. We only have a little bit less than a minute, but this was the best election showing for Republican presidential candidates since George W. Bush won New Mexico in 2004. Trump made gains in over 2020 in 30 of 33 counties here. What's behind that shift?
Yeah, I mean, I think clearly Donald Trump was able to tap into some voter sentiment, even in some parts of New Mexico with large Hispanic populations and Native American populations, and make some inroads there that Republicans, frankly, hadn't been able to in past years. You know, obviously, he wasn't able to win the state like he said he was going to when he came, but he did make it much closer than we've seen in recent years. And I think the question going forward was whether that's kind of a flash in the pan or just due to some of the economic conditions right now, or whether that's something that, you know, Republicans can kind of tap into going forward.
Okay. And one note for our viewers as we move on here, Heinrich earned 3,000 more votes than Harris in Bernalillo County. So that was just an interesting tidbit that we found. Now, thank you all. We'll be back here in less than a minute to talk about the state's legislative races, including a razor-thin one in southern New Mexico.